said in the open, it was my first professor in the master program that I did in Europe, so I learned a lot from him. So nice to see you here, nice to come here, and I enjoy the conference.
Thank you. Nice to be in spring. Day before yesterday, there was snow on the ground where I live, so I'm happy to be here. So when Gabriela asked me to come, first thing I told her was, I'm not doing small talk anymore. I'm not a small talk user these days. I ended up doing very low level stuff these days, which I'm going to talk about tomorrow. Because Gabriela said, yeah, you can also talk about what you're doing now. So she had two speeches. Yeah? And I don't know whether you convinced Brian to do two, because I did two all the other way around.
Yeah? No. Something. You said me one, and you say I need another one.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Thank
yeah.
you.
Yeah. So I'm probably right. We got played off against one another. Okay, so let's see. This is a PowerPoint version of my original version, so I don't know what's going to happen. This is probably going to crash and burn along the way. Anyway, so I had some fancy stuff in there, which you see is not working. Yeah, okay. So, brief. So I'm going to try and do half an hour on history, because it's history, which is things from the past. And In Brussels, well, the capital of Europe and also the capital of one of the silliest countries in the world. Also in the news these days, right, because of the Catalan question. And actually, Fedivert, the Minister of the Interior of Belgium, who had a really high discussion with Rajoy, is actually a computer science graduate from my university. So I had him as a student. Not particularly proud of it, but just thought I'd tell you. So we have two of everything. So there's a Dutch-speaking one and there's a French-speaking one, right across from one another with totally different rules. You don't want to know about that. Software Languages Lab goes back to 87. Yeah, before that, we were Department of Mathematics. And then me, well, actually, the biography on the website of the conference is totally legacy. Yeah? So this, I submitted this one as a real biography, but it didn't make it to the website. So there it is. And the key element is that I'm an emeritus professor, which means that I'm retired, but still active. So I still teach. I still do research, but I don't get bothered with the really BS that professors these days are bothered with. So I'm happy, I do what I want. So this is the abstract. So I'm going to leave the version of the presentation for today and tomorrow here, so you can read up on it if you want to. We were, I guess, the first ones to have the Blue Book in Belgium. Yeah, because we had been looking out for it, following it. It's pretty hard in 1983 to follow something which happens 9 hours away, yeah, in California. But still we did it, so we were the first probably to have the book. And I copied a couple of things out of the book which talks about implementation of Smalltalk. I don't know whether anyone ever read that in detail, but you need a big bitmap. You need a mouse, yeah, and you need a hard disk, which is pretty hard, these things, to have in 1983. Now, fortunately, we were well prepared, so we ordered this. This is an original release tape of Smalltalk 2. I took this picture some time ago because many people wanted to have one. I don't have the tape anymore because Robert Hirschfeld in Potsdam was so anxious to have it that I gave it to him. So if you want to have a look at it, you have to make a pilgrimage to Potsdam. What we had at that moment We had our students working on Motorola 68K educational sets. That was absolutely spectacular at that moment. Yeah? The first really 32-bit machine cost not all that much. And we had 10 of those, and students used it. So we had expertise in place to have used some hardware that was sufficiently powerful to run things like Smalltalk. We had some expertise in displays. So the Bananas is on a Barco monitor. Barco is a Belgian brand. So we had access to those. And we were experimenting with the very second, I think, not the first, the second graphical coprocessor. NEC did that one. So I actually wrote the driver for that. Very exciting. So we needed a mouse. And fortunately, the year before that, Logitech came out with this one. Yeah? We had a blue one. I don't have it anymore. Yeah? It grew legs. Yeah? And it walked away. Somebody took it as a souvenir. Same for the book. I don't have the book anymore either. We had access at that time to a control data machine. Yeah, which the same brand as machine which was at CERN and in Zurich, where Niklaus Wirth is as a professor. And Wirth on the bottom right hand side had done a sabbatical at Park Place. So he wanted to build a machine of his own, so he built the Lilith desktop machine. And he was entirely programmed in Modula 2, and fortunately he had built Modula 2 to 68,000 cross compiler running on that machine. That's what we used. This is our Smalltalk machine. Pretty horrible. And this is the front side, and you'll see that's a hard disk, a removable 5 megabyte hard disk. Yeah? And a connector for the display. At the bottom, a connector for the mouse. A simple serial connection, so no USB didn't exist, nothing existed. Yeah? And also a connector for telecom. No Ethernet, a serial link. So we did everything over serialized. Pretty hard. This is the machine. I took these pictures last week. I've never did this kind of presentation, so you're my victims. So this is the processor board, 68,000 in the middle. Yeah? 32-bit machine, but 16-bit bus. Yeah. Later on, they were produced with 32-bit buses as well. Well, if you count the legs, the connector, you know it's not a 32-bit going out. This is 0.5 megabyte of memory. Yeah. So if you count the chips, if you count the chips, you have 64K bit chips here. Yeah, pretty expensive. Yeah, you can't possibly imagine this today, but that's what we had to work with. This is the graphics processor. It's got a bitmap, but it was more or less accessible. That's the disk controller. I just want to show you this stuff. It's really awful. So the results. The bottom, it says we had 3 students doing the interpreter, the memory manager, the graphics, including user interface, and so on. The result was a VM written in Modula 2 based on the specifications of the Blue Book. Yeah. Other people did that, but I think if there were other people in Europe doing that, I don't know them. Edited on a mainframe, yeah, the old days. Cross-compiled to a 68K. Yeah. That's PowerPoint. acting up. Yeah. Download it over a serial link. Yeah. Don't underestimate that. Yeah. And so three students did that. Brilliant guys. Yeah. And the result was something that worked. So we did this because we were interested in building it, not in using it. We knew beforehand that this was not going to be very usable. But it worked. So we could do some of the code that was on the tape.
Yeah. So may I ask a question?
Yeah.
Did you do all this with the support from Cerebus in any way?
Support from?
Cerebus.
No. We did it completely on our own. As I said, 9 hours away, it was very hard. We only got into touch with people afterwards. So this was a closed community activity. We just wanted to get the experience. That was our first experience with Smalltalk, and since we knew the inside and we read the book really in detail, we were convinced. The guy on the right is a colleague of mine who retired last month, Luke Stales. He brought artificial intelligence over from MIT to Brussels. We still have a pretty strong research group in that direction as well. And the first thing he did when he came over to Brussels, it was also in 83, was order a couple of symbolics machines. I don't know whether you heard of those machines, but they're the absolute top. If today we had this kind of machinery and software with the kind of power we have today, yeah, all our problems would be solved. I'm exaggerating. So this inspired us. Now, at about the same time, Alan and Rebecca Weres-Brock were doing exactly the same thing as us, but with Pascal, yeah, but in collaboration with Tektronix. And they built a machine, also a 68,000 machine. And this one was operational. You could use it. So we fairly rapidly switched to this machine to do small talk in the beginning. And after a couple of years, we switched to Apple to run small talk. Okay, excuse me for a minute. So what I did here is list the top 5 things that my grandchildren would call cool. Yeah? But that's a word that didn't exist at that time. So what was the most impressive thing for me and the students, because we're working in a team? Well, the idea that everything was an object. Absolutely crazy at that time. The second thing, that you have this one-to-one mapping between classes and meta-classes. Yeah? Solving an issue. Yeah? That was really, really cool, we found at that time. That there was a very much more complex meta-level architecture behind it, we couldn't care. And then something that you might not find so important, which is the notion of indexed instance variables. We really thought that was really cool. You know why? Because in just about every other language that you can see at that moment, there was no unification between the notion of an object and the notion of an array. Yeah? Even today, in lots of languages that are used today, there's a difference. Okay? We thought this was, oops, I'm forgetting my thingy. Another thing that we found very cool is the bit block transfer. The first time we heard about it was then. Yeah. Really, really yeah. Blew our mind. I'll tell more about it in a minute. And then you're going to laugh at me. Small ints. I'm writing virtual machine and memory manager all the time. I still call them small ints. Yeah. That was also a really mind-blowing idea, we felt. Now, you're going to probably have a number of things that are more important than those. So I also listed the top five things we said, okay, that's normal. Yeah. So the first one was bytecodes. So I guess 10 years before that, I had been doing work with BCPL, yeah, which is a programming language, a precursor to C, which had O codes, yeah, same as bytecodes. So we were familiar with that. Circularity, the fact of writing things in the language they're describing. Yeah? Well, in 75, Pascal was distributed. Well, actually, BCPL was already distributed in BCPL, but Pascal in 75, Modula 2 was distributed in itself, so that was no big deal. Huh? Object tables, bad idea. Yeah? Unless you want become to be efficient. Yeah? Right? So I seem to remember that Squeak threw them out, and they had some difficulty in making become reasonably efficient. Yeah? Interpreters. Again, no big deal. We were doing that. Blocks. Yeah, this morning there was a discussion about blocks. No big deal. Yeah, blocks are another color for closures, in my book. Yeah. And already at that time we were exposed to Lispy stuff. So Luc Steels, my colleague, yeah, they ran Zeta Lisp on the symbolics. They ran flavors on the symbolics. Yeah, and those things, flavor is pretty strong. Zeta Lisp, the dialect of Lisp, was pretty strong, and they had things like that. So, again, no big deal. Unreadable. A strange side effect. At the same time, we had a lot of IBM PCs for teaching and so on, and people wanted to do graphics, and I came up with this, which is a small library for an IBM PC to do or to prepare for something bit block transfer like on an IBM PC. Yeah? So on top of that you had other stuff to do, rectangles and circles and what have you. And you might recognize the terminology. And this, the last time I noticed people using this at universities, only a couple of years ago. So this was pretty popular. Don't ask me why. Probably because it was cheap. Okay. This is Europe. I thought it was a good idea to show us where we are. We're here. Yeah. And I'm also going to show you where our small talk friends today are, so that you have an idea of what contacts we have. The name fell this morning, Stéphane Ducasse. Yeah, he's half an hour train ride away from us. We work together with him very much. Yeah? I'll come back to that later. Oscar Nierstraas, yeah? Gabriela talked about him. Yeah? He came to Smalltalk fairly late, but he's convinced. Michele Lanza, there's an Italian-speaking university in Italy, that's where he is. And another one that I mentioned before because he's got my tape, Robert Hirschfeld in Berlin. Yeah? We had, still have, a lot of contact with small talk-related people across the world. Dave Thomas helped us with getting financing from IBM in 98 when we did eCoop in Brussels. Who else? Adele Goldberg was on different PhD committees with us, so we knew those people. Dave Ungar. We only recently had projects together with him, so we have some contacts elsewhere as well. This is totally unreadable, so I'll tell you what this says. Yeah. How do I best tell you what research we do related to Smalltalk? That's a list of PhDs since 94 that used Smalltalk as a platform. So, yeah. The first one in 94 on reflection. This is the PhD by Roel Wertz. You might know him. Yeah? He's been very active in the community. He was the first one to introduce rules to small talk, which he's called Rule, and he, whatever. Yeah. I couldn't pass this by. That's my daughter. Yeah? She did her PhD with a colleague of mine. And I mention her here because she was probably the first to combine small talk with aspects. Yeah? Transactions, Johan was for many years in the faculty of the University of Chile in Santiago. Yeah? These two guys, you probably have met them as well, Johan Brichot and Andy Kellens, also very active in ESAG, used to. And they have a company in Ghent, which is one of the foremost companies in Europe using Smalltalk for their product. Yeah. And this is someone from Argentina. That's why I put it. Veronica is from Ecuador. And I mention her because she had a co-tutelle, which is a shared PhD between Stefan and me. Yeah. And then the last one on top, Stefan, is German. He got sent to us by Robert Hirschfeld because he hated small talk. And he ended up doing a PhD using small talk. Yeah. So the topics, computational, if I go through this rapidly, hypertext, software reuse, a lot of that, language symbiosis, so combining the Smalltalk platform with another language, typically a declarative language. We use that, for instance, to specify aspects and stuff like that. You're absolutely right when you say that aspects are dead today, and I'm willing to entertain any discussion on why, yeah? And it doesn't have much to do with the aspects themselves, but with other things. Software evolution, aspects, software engineering, user interfaces. Actually, the top one also went to do to use self. That's the first time we had Dave Ungar in a PhD committee. And language engineering, which is actually my field of interest. I'm not so much interested in software or in software engineering. Those are my colleagues. I like making, like implementing language. And tomorrow I'm going to be talking about very low-level stuff, because I ended up doing that probably because nobody else wanted to do it. Okay, half an hour. So small talk in education. We, from the very beginning, refused to use an object-oriented language as a first language in computer science. And I'm willing, again, to entertain a discussion. Not now. Yeah? We always went strongly for objects afterwards. Yeah? Oops, I'm forgetting again. Yeah. We always use Smalltalk as a role model, and I'm going to give an example of that in a minute. We've had a class called Principles of OO Language since forever, and it's been stopped 2 years ago. Why? Because we think objects have arrived. Yeah. It's no longer necessary to teach people, teach students about objects. They do it by themselves. And I'm still teaching a class, and in this class I'm placing small talk as a language that plays an important role in the evolution of languages. What language do we use in the first year? Scheme. Since 91, we're using Abelson and Sussman's book, yeah, which was abandoned by MIT a couple of years ago in favor of Python, which is an absolute mistake. It's a mistake. Yeah. And I'm not the only one saying that. And every year we again ask the question, should we replace Scheme by something else? And every year we search our conscience and whatever, and we say, no, we're going to continue teaching Scheme. Not only because we decided, but because our graduates say we need to do that, and so on. So, okay. Yeah, you can't see this, but this is the code from the Blue Book for the collection hierarchy. The part on, remember the one with an abstract dictionary and a fast dictionary and a small dictionary, that one? Yeah, part of it. This is the same in Scheme. Yeah, with exactly the same semantics. Huh? You probably hate all the parentheses, but that's the price you pay for doing Scheme. I hear people say that writing in Lispy-like languages is like programming in XML. Not true. The uppercase stuff are macros. And I'll show you a couple of the macros. We've been using this for a long time because those of you who know Scheme, notice that these are not lexical macros from Scheme. These are the old style macros. So this is as old as that. And I wrote this. In 170 lines of code, I provide the entire semantics of Smalltalk on top of Scheme. So this was the way to convince people about, who were raised in Scheme, convince them about Smalltalk. And I'm betting that they knew more about Smalltalk than many other people who were only raised in Scheme, because it makes explicit in the macros the method tables and so on. Not this version, but there's a next version which does lexical addressing. It's slightly bigger, but not much. Okay? So that's how we did it. Smalltalk in development. Mediagenics is a company that we started, I think, in the early 90s, that actually Adele Goldberg pushed a lot. Yeah. So for the moment, I don't have much contact with them. They're very well established. They do planning software for television stations and so on. The second one, YesPlan, is the one created by the two guys I mentioned before in Ghent. They do planning for events like games, theater concerts and stuff like that. And I had I talked with James day before, yeah? And you know these guys, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Smart people.
I'm glad you think so, because I think so too. Yeah. So, I want to spend a bit of time. So this is history. Yeah? I hope this gives you an impression of a research group that is pretty successful, lots of PhDs, lots of publications, active in objects, for a long time active using Smalltalk, with spin-offs to all kinds of things. So, how are objects doing today? This is something, I put these, the first things that came to my mind. Yeah? So probably I'm going to make some people angry. First of all, there's an ubiquity. So objects are ubiquitous. They're everywhere. Yeah? You have a hard time finding languages that don't have objects as their prime data structure. Yeah? So they're everywhere, so everybody knows about them, and that was one of the reasons why we decided to stop with a specific course on objects. Now, is everything really an object? Because that's what things seem to say, and I tend not to agree, and again, I'm not the only one. So in our program, we have put a lot of accents on other paradigms. We still have a course on logic programming. We have several courses on functional programming because it's coming up. We have lots of stuff on concurrent programming. Yeah. Those seem to be things that not always combine that well with objects. Yeah. We have done and still are doing a lot of work on actor-based systems. With all kinds of problems and all kinds of results. I don't have the time to go into that. Object literacy. So you would expect if every language is object-oriented, that everybody would really know what objects are. I had a discussion over lunch with people, and they told me I was extremely pessimistic. My experience by talking with people, by talking with graduate students who come in from outside, yeah, is that the literacy about objects is extremely low. Yeah. I challenge you to ask the odd Java programmer what the difference is between this and super. Yeah. And in most cases, they won't be able to answer. Late binding, forget about it. Anyway, my point is that objects are far less well known than they used to be, when object-oriented programming was much more limited. So I hear a lot of people say that inheritance is far too complicated. Yeah. So why not do away with it? Call me old-fashioned, but I don't think that's a good idea. And then you see Swiss Army knives. Yeah. I don't need to explicitly stick the name of a programming language on that. It's very well constructed. Yeah? The people who are doing it are very competent, but it's so big and heavy. A much more important question, because that was only about objects. How is programming doing? And again, at this earlier today, I was accused of being a pessimist and that I was depressing people. Yeah? I'm joking. Yeah? But why do so many people hate dynamic languages? Yeah? Listen to what people are saying, and they hate it. Yeah? So how about JavaScript? Where did that come from? How is the major representative of dynamic languages such a bastard child of Scheme? It's awful. Yeah? So even if we want to push dynamic languages, an extra obstacle is over there. Oops. Academia. I'm going to criticize myself or my environment. I'm taking as an example ECOOP, the European Conference on Objects, which I used to be helped build it. Yeah? We've had a conference early on, a very successful one. When I look at ECOOP, when we did it in 98, and at ECOOP 20 years later, yeah? It's totally different. So apparently this conference and many other conferences have been hijacked by people who either go for the very formal side of things or the very empirical side of things, well, serious empirical side of things, and what's in the middle is lost. And everything that, in my book, used to make programming so attractive is shunned. Try to submit a paper. Yeah, I found this cool thing in Smalltalk. Please publish. You'll get kicked out immediately. Another thing. Well, this is a bitching list, right? The ascendance of language pragmatism. Now I'm going to name something. Python. Yeah? Python is an example of a very successful language today, but it's the summum of pragmatism. Yeah? And the reason I'm told that MIT has switched to Python as a first language is because there are a lot of, let's call them, engineering decisions behind that. Engineers like tools and practical things and blah, blah, blah. That's another discussion. But you see it in general. Programming is, and that's my last point here, considered an art. Remember Donald Knuth? Yeah? The art of computer programming. Why are you getting laughed at when you say that some of the times when you have this really nice piece of code that you feel yourself like an artist? Yeah? Certainly you people who have been doing Smalltalk, you have felt that you're particularly proud of something that you assembled, that you put together, yeah? Which really feels good. Yeah? Publicity. So we got together 2 years ago, and we, Robert Hirschfeld, who else was there? Richard Gabriel. You know, Richard Gabriel is the guy who puts Uppsala back on track with Splash. Yeah? Krista Lopez. Yeah? The guy who's in my shoes now in the lab, Wolfgang de Meuter, me, and we decided to hijack the steering committee funds generated by Aspects. Yeah? There's a steering committee which has put together a lot of money from organizing Aspect conferences, but now Aspects are... So 2 years ago we decided to restructure things and do a new kind of conference. And the first one of those was earlier this year in Brussels. Yeah? And the conference is called The Art, Science and Engineering of Programming. But I'm going to come back to that, to the name. We're stuck with the name. I wanted technology rather than engineering, but I got voted out because the American people in our little group decided that was not a good idea to mention the name technology. I'm on record for saying that mathematics is also technology. So it's in that sense that I meant it, but so it went over not well, so that's the title. Programming with angles, that's because we couldn't find an acronym. Yeah? So Dick Gabriel used a placeholder for the name of the conference, that one, and it stuck. Yeah? Yeah. So, and we have people at ACM joking about this, that they were waiting for angle/programming. Yeah. Yeah. So anyway, we did not manage to attract the Smalltalk people. We did not manage to attract ESER. But for instance, the European Lisp Symposium, which is more than 100 people, was there. Yeah? Was pretty successful. We had about 250 people for the first time around. I was happy. Second point about this, and this is what we're trying to do to reactivate at least the possibility to submit papers on the middle region. Yeah? in between formal and empirical stuff. And we don't do that with proceedings, because proceedings are out in academia. Academia wants journals. So we started up an open access journal. This is the one. Yeah. If you're interested, look it up. I strongly invite people to publish. And if they have something they want to publish and they have a problem finding a place to publish it, please try out this one. So Krista Lopez is the editor-in-chief. And I'll show you a list of people in a minute to show you that this is pretty serious. So we've had 4 issues until today. Yeah. And we're waiting for submissions by December at the latest, I guess, to be able to be presented at the conference next year. So we have a conference next year in a particularly nice place. Yeah. We already have Genoa scheduled for the year after, and Porto the year after. So this is, and we have people pushing this. So please, 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 take this seriously. That's the intention. Yeah. Okay. This is managed by a steering committee, and I wanted to mention this because this is the list of names who are members of the steering committee, and some of them are pretty well known, and they're from all over the world, as you can see. I'm the chairman for the moment. They caught me in a weak moment, because you really don't want to do that. Do you know AOSA is actually a non-profit company in California? So according to the bylaws, I'm the CEO of an American company. No kidding. Yeah. So I'm okay with time, right? So I'm going to have time for questions. Huh? So I could have spent more time on the initial part, but I didn't. I'm leaving the slides. You can have a look at them afterwards. So last time I did something like this, meaning talking to a room full of small talk people. It was a dozen years ago at an ESUG conference, which happened to be in Brussels. Yeah. And I was asked to do a keynote, and I looked it up, of course, to see whether it was still valid. If I had given this keynote today, would it still have worked? And the answer is yes. Yeah? And the keynote was 10 reasons why I hate small talk. And I did what the French call a contre-pied, which is saying the opposite of what you mean. So, and 10 things. And I picked out the last one. Huh? Small talk programmers have too much fun for their own good. That was the 10th point. And I think it's, well, mutatis mutandis, the condition. Yeah? This is still valid. Yeah? Small talk, one of the features of small talk, it's fun doing that. Yeah? It still is, and that's probably the major reason why, well, I guess some people here in the room do small talk because that's a way to make a living. Well, okay, you have fun making a living. So let me read this. That's part of the, yeah, you are actually using a simplistic language that hasn't changed in 20 years, 30 years now, yeah, that possesses some really awful features, and that on top of this you enjoy using. And yet you say that you can build software faster and better than all of those real programmers using real languages. And I think that's still valid. And that's my talk. Thank you.
when you show us Mozart for the first time, was common at that time. So what have you seen that now is not that common? People don't understand it, don't use it, don't see it. At least that's why I see.
Are you saying it's uncommon in small talk these days?
No, not in small talk. In other languages, if you talk to a Java guy, he doesn't understand what it really means, or a C-sharp guy, or a Python guy.
I haven't a clue why that is the case. The only explanation I can come up with is lack of education. So in many cases, people learn a language on its own without context, without being member of a computer science program or whatever. So the surrounding stuff is absent. So if you go to a professional training in order to learn about C#, you don't get exposed to that. But did you know that C# people know what closures are? Because as far as I remember, in C# you can assign a method to a variable and it creates a closure. Yeah. So, and in some classes people are smart enough to explain it in that fashion. So yeah, it's opportunity. That's the only explanation I have.
So you mentioned that for you, objects are ubiquitous. You said that objects are everywhere. Ubiquitous, you mentioned that
they're ubiquitous.
Yes, sir. But I think it's not like that. I mean, if C Java, not everything is an object. It's Python, not everything is an object. So I think that we still have a problem that objects are noisy everywhere, and so I want to understand why you said that, why you feel that everybody see that everything is an object when...
No, that's not what I said.
Oh, sorry.
I said that in small talk everything is an object. That was remarkable for us at that time. No, most languages today are hybrid. Yeah, they have a procedural component and they have an object, but they all have an object-oriented component. Yeah? And that's the hard part. Everybody knows what a while loop is, but not everybody knows what delegation is. Yeah? And you will find people who manifestly say, we want both. So common Lisp is Lisp plus objects. And common Lisp people use both of them, but in general they're competent because you have to be competent to use Common Lisp, yeah? Otherwise you're lost. But many languages have objects and people use objects as their main structuring mechanism. Yeah? And they use imperative stuff, procedural stuff for other things inside smaller parts. But there are objects everywhere. And that seems to be the main driving argument behind using a particular language. That's what I meant to say. You're talking about the conference. Yeah, it's open to all. When you went to Uppsala 20 years ago, yeah, there was still a big room with demo, yeah, with people demonstrating products. Yeah, Gemstone was there. Yeah? Visual Works was there. Everybody was there. Yeah, that's no longer the case. So we want this to be accessible to practitioners as well. That's explicit on the call when we invite people to come to the conference. That's absolutely the idea.
But I didn't see a place to propose a talk, like for example, we do in this conference. We have to write a research paper, or we have to propose a workshop. So it sounds more like an academic one.
Well, there's an academic core in exactly the same way that there was an academic core before with Uppsala or ECOOP. Yeah? And then you have, just as you have here, you have workshops. You have co-located events. So we had the European LISP symposium there with, as I said, many people. Most of them were practitioners. Yeah? And we actually want to provide also some kind of, a clothes tree. That's correct in English, right? Where you hang your coat on. Yeah? We want to provide one of those so that people can come in and hang their version of programming there. And it can be academic, but it can be anything. Here you go.
I have a question. Comment. As you are still locating a lot of different conferences, but they're still mostly tech. So they're not bringing in industry, and they're not bringing in sessions where you can engage with more people who are. I get academics, I have those talks and papers, but if you really want to include industry, you need to open it up, it needs to be promoted in a different way, it needs to get out there. I've been talking with the Splash, Uppsala, Bob, and everyone else at that conference, because they wanted to know how can we get more people coming here and talk about how they're actually using these solutions, they're using these methodologies, because that's lacking. You know, he left the program last year, just like this right here, and it looked like a great conference, but again, if you look what I've done, then where from industry or where would those people go to sign up? And I think when you were saying pain your, maybe that birds of a feather or a more open general session, is that kind of what you meant?
Yes, well, actually. This is the very first issue of something totally new that we had to create with a lot of opposition, because there are still the original steering committee still counts a number of aspect people who see their livelihood being attacked or whatever. Yeah? So we had to fight against them to do this. So we still had a co-located event on modularity, which is actually the aspect people. So we couldn't change from one to the other end immediately. So what we did now in order to attract people from industry is have a bottom-up approach. So we try to attract programmers. Yeah? And for instance, the LISP symposium people were like that. If they are higher level people in an organization, it's because it's a very small organization and they themselves also are participating in the development. Actually, to be quite honest, I don't want a project manager to be there, somebody from a large company, because he won't match with the kind of thing that we're aiming at, which is this, what these people mostly are here, yeah? Which is people who enjoy what they're doing, who are artisans, if you want. And that's who we want to address. And lots of them are academic, but lots of them are from we would really like to have to convince ESUG to come and participate. And maybe we'll get there if we can convince Robert Hirschfeld and Stefan Ducasse to talk to one another, which they're not doing at the moment. I don't know, this is growing. Yeah? I'm not the only one pushing this. Other people are equally sensitive to what you're raising, which is industry participation. Hopefully we'll be getting there, but it was not my intention here to argue the use of or disuse of this conference. I'm just saying we're trying to do something about it, and whether it will be successful, we'll see.
Yeah, no, I didn't even argue with Brian, because I've seen the decline of Slash dramatically. I was pretty shocked last year when I was used to thousands and thousands of people we used to go, as I said, I was really shocked. And to be there last week, a week ago, whenever it was, just a declining conference that used to be just massive, with a nice blend of academia and industry. And
I fully agree with you, and that evolution is something that pushed us to do this. Yeah, I don't know what's going to. But you'll notice that it's for the moment looking at the next places where this will take place. Although the money is located in California, the action is located in Europe. Yeah? So it's a European thing. Yeah, and we'll see what happens. But indeed, Splash. Well, if Splash hadn't been created, there would have been nothing today. Yeah? Uppsala would be dead. So it's a last-ditch effort, I agree, but yep.
I just want to say that some things happen in California that happen universally. Well, I happen in California, so you're Europe and everywhere else in the world.
Here you go.
Hi, at the beginning of the talk, said it may not be wise to start the SEOs of informatic listening in an observatory program. It would be not a sad way to approach it. Okay, why do you think that? Why is not the better way to learn that?
So the question is, why do we not use Smalltalk as a first language? Yeah, that's actually your question. Yeah. Well, because we use Scheme, and in Scheme, most of the questions that arose this morning are trivial questions. Yeah. So we feel that we can expose students, 18-year-olds, to concepts which are impossible to present in another context. You should realize that in one academic year. Well, if you're at all familiar with the Abelson and Sussman book, yeah, it starts with really complicated stuff. Yeah, using closures as objects, using streams, delayed evaluation. It presents meta-circularity. It presents a logic programming language. It does a compiler. It does garbage collection. It does everything within the scope of one language in one book. So the language is not important, but what you can do with the language is important.
Put the microphone down.
So which part do I need to repeat?
Everything.
I didn't catch that, so. Read the book. Read the book, and you'll know why. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Despite PowerPoints.